Good day everyone. Today we will discuss about the concept of stress, which is part of the module 1. Stress is one of the most important concepts in mechanics of material. In fact, it occurs in every chapter of this subject. So a thorough understanding of stress is very much important. We have a similar concept called strain also, which is also equally important, that we will discuss in the next class. Now as the name. Okay, let us see the concept of stress. Now, the stress and strains are commonly heard terms with respect to human beings. But do the materials also have stress and strains? Let us see in this class. So, before we get into the stress, a concept called resolution of force is required. Let me quickly summarize this. Here, as you can see, a force F is applied at this point, making an angle theta with the x-axis. And this force may produce an acceleration or may actually tend to produce an acceleration. If the body is in equilibrium, then it will not produce acceleration, but it will only tend to produce acceleration. Now, whatever effect this force is causing on the body can be achieved by applying another two components of forces called Fx and Fy. That means either you apply a force F making an angle theta, or you can apply X component and Y component perpendicular as shown in this figure, it will get the same effect. That is, both the systems are equivalent. So, if you want to find out what are the forces to be applied to replace the effect of this F making angle theta, then we have a formula. This Fx is given by F cos theta and Fy, that is vertical component, is given by F sin theta. Okay, so here either you apply F making angle theta with the x-axis, or you can simply apply two perpendicular forces Fx and Fy making an angle 90 degree between them. The same formula is given here. If you take an example, for example, you have 125 newton making an angle 40 degree with the x-axis, then the horizontal component is 125 cos 40, which is 95.8, and a vertical component 80.3. So it means if you want to apply a force of 125 newton making an angle 40 degree with x-axis, it will produce some effect. The same effect can be achieved by applying two forces. One is 95.8 newton along x-axis, another one is 80.3 along y-axis. So these two are equivalent forces. Suppose in this diagram, carefully observe, we have shown 125 as well as fxx, but this is not right. What you should do is you remove this out. Okay, either you show 125 or you show fx or fy. In this diagram, since I have removed out 125, only fx, fy are there. So this will be the effect of 125 newton replaced by two components. Okay, then the concept of stress. Stress can be understood in two perspectives. One is applied stress perspective, another one is internal stress perspective. In your textbook, mostly it is internal stress concept that is given. However, it is important to understand the applied stress concept also. So, let me, before we get into this question, let me take an hypothetical case where, let's say, happiness of kids is measured by number of apples provided to the kid. Now here I am giving an hypothetical case where family A, the head of the family, is buying 8 apples and family B is buying 12 apples. Now the question is, which family is happier? Whose family kids are happier? So obviously we tend to think that because there are 12 apples, the family B is more happier than family A. But wait, now family A has got 2 kids and family B has got 12 kids. Now the kids in family A will get 4 apples each, whereas the kids in family B will get only 1 apple each. So which family is happier? Of course, the kids in the family are happier, obviously. So what I mean by this is, so it is not important how much apples you bring, rather how much apples each kid gets is important. So it is the concept of per member per kid, per area is an important concept that you will see later. In case of stress also, this becomes an important concept. For example, I have taken a surface, the surface like this, and I want to apply some forces. So here, let me take the dimensions of the surface as each one is 1 meter, 1 meter. Okay, that means effectively this horizontal is 4 meter. This is also 1, 1, 1. So this is a 4 cross 4 area, that is 4 cross 4 meter square area. Now I am applying a force of 32 newton on this. Now if you concentrate on each square area here, okay, this is of the area 1 meter square. Okay, now what is the force on this 1 meter square? Just observe, there are 4 cross 4, that is 16 squares like this, and the total force is 32 newtons. Now how much is the force on each square? So let me say 32 newton is applied divided by how many? 16 meter square. So each square meter will get 2 newton per meter square of force. That means each force, this is of value 2 newton. So 16 into 2, you will get 30 newton sum. So each force is 2 newton, like this, 2 newton. So similar to the concept of happiness with respect to apples, here it is found that failure of materials is dependent on, not on the total applied force, but it's dependent on how much each square area gets. That means this acid area is getting 2 newton per meter square. So this becomes an important concept to find out whether the material is going to fail or not. Therefore, scientists thought we will introduce a concept called stress. That is, now we'll say it is applied stress. Now, what is another name for applied stress? It is known as intensity of force, that is force per unit area. So the definition of stress is, it is force per unit area. That means what is the force each meter square area gets is your stress. Because we are applying force on the surface, sometimes this term stress is called applied stress, because we are applying some force on the area and we are measuring how much is the force on each meter square area, that is unit area, then that will become the concept of stress. This stress is given by a symbol sigma. This is your sigma, and sigma, as you can see from this definition, 32 newton is the force and 16 is our area. So in terms of mathematical equation, we write this as P by A, force by area. So the units are, P is measured in newtons and area is measured in meter square. So the stress is measured in terms of newton per meter square. We already know that 1 newton per meter square is equal to 1 pascal, which might have studied in your fluid mechanics also. But it so happens the materials can take much more stress than 1 pascal. So usually it is 1 megapascal that is important to us, that is 10 power 6 pascal is equal to 1 megapascal. So in terms of megapascal, we usually measure the concept of stress in mechanics of materials. To summarize, we have defined stress, that is applied stress, as force per unit area. So you have to find out what is the total force acting divided by the area, and how much each square meters meter square area gets, that will be your stress. Okay, now let us discuss the second approach of stress, called developed stress or internal stress. As usual, we'll make some basic assumptions. Okay, the first one is body is under equilibrium. Okay, so that means if I take, let me a body F here, and I'm applying a force of F. Okay, so when you apply a force F, this force will try to accelerate the body in the upward direction. If you want the body to be under equilibrium, what you have to do is you have to apply a force downward, and this F should be equal and opposite to the applied F. So then the body is under equilibrium. So that means body is not accelerating, it is under equilibrium. The second assumption is we are considering prismatic bars in our examples. Prismatic means you can, okay, these are some of the prismatic bars. Here you have a cylinder whose cross section remains same throughout, and a prismatic bar, a box kind of thing, where the rectangular cross section is same throughout from this end to this end, and of course a triangular prismatic bar where we have got a triangular cross section. Okay, so we will for the time being restrict our discussion to the prismatic bars. Later we will see how this can be extended to stepped bar and other other bodies whose cross section varies. Okay, let me take a case of a bar. I'll just show the 2D diagram here. Okay, a bar is shown here. What I'll do is I'll apply a force F in this, like this, in the left direction. Now if I don't do anything, this body will move or accelerate towards left in this fashion. So the first assumption is the body is under equilibrium. So what you have to do is you have to apply equal and opposite force like this. Okay, this is your F, so that the body is now under equilibrium. Now what we do is we'll find out, imagine I'm cutting the body here. Okay, if you want to understand the equilibrium of the left portion like this, okay, here you have applied a force, you have no problem. Whereas if you observe this cross section area, there is no force applied directly, rather there is other surface which is in contact. So this portion, the right hand portion, is in contact. Now if this body has to be under equilibrium, somebody should apply an equal and opposite force on this left hand portion, so that the body is not moving. So who is that somebody? This is nothing but the right hand portion is in contact with all these points throughout the surface. Okay, so that means if the body is under equilibrium, this right hand force must be applying a force like this. Okay, these I call it as resistive forces. Why resistive force? Because it is resisting the motion of the left hand side body. So the forces applied by the right hand side on the left hand side are resistive forces. If I want to measure the intensity of these forces, that means if I know the forces, please remember, whatever force these are applying, the small forces, they should finally sum up to this F only. Because if it is less than F, then this will move towards left. If it is more than F, then it will move towards right. So if the body is under equilibrium, all the sum of these forces must be equal to F only. Okay, now let's come back and find out what is the intensity of this force. So what is the force per unit area, like we discussed in applied stress also. So for that we'll say sigma is equal to P or F by A. What is F? This is sum of forces, sum of forces applied by the right hand side on the left hand side, divided by the cross-sectional area. So this intensity of resistive force is known as internal stress or developed stress. Okay, so to summarize, stress is the resistive force per unit area. Okay, now the question comes, why only left hand side? You can as well take the right hand side also, no problem, you can as well take right hand side. Let us see, draw the free body diagram of the right hand portion. Okay, let me say this is right hand portion. This right hand portion is, of course, this side you are applying a force here. Okay, if this right hand portion should not move towards the right, then there must be a small some of these forces acting. Okay, so that this body is not moving. Who is applying this force? These are the forces applied by the left hand portion on the right hand portion. Okay, these are again resistive force, because this is applied by left hand force, this will stop the this right hand portion from moving towards right. So these are resistive forces. So the resistive force divided by the area is again internal stress. Okay, so therefore internal stress is nothing but the intensity of internal resistance or internal force per unit area. Sometimes we also call use the word developed stress, because you are applying a force F, then only these internal stresses have come into picture. So these have been developed because of the applied force. Okay, mathematically the equation again remains same. Sigma is equal to P by A. P is measured in Newton, A in meter square. So naturally 1 Newton per meter square, which is Pascal, again mega Pascal is what. So what is the difference between applied stress and internal stress? Mathematically everything remains same. Only thing, in applied stress you are applying on the outside surface, okay, and that force per unit area is your applied stress. If it is inside the body, an imaginary cut is made and the forces acting on them are measured, then you will call it as internal stress. Okay, to summarize, we know the stress is given by sigma is equal to P by A, whether it is applied stress or internal stress, the formula remains same. Okay, now I'll take a simple formula, simple example basically. We have a cross section area of 4 meter square and I'm applying a force of 10 Newton per meter square. So what is the stress developed? So that means there is an area, okay, like this. This is of side, let us say 2 meter and 2 meter, so that area cross section becomes 4 meter square. Okay, so this is your cross section area. On that you are applying force of 10 newton, sorry, this is not Newton per meter square, you are just applying 10 Newton only. Now the sigma is given by P by A, that is 10 by 4, that will be 2.5 Newton per meter square is your stress. So before we conclude this concept, I would like to ask the important question: is stress a scalar or vector? Think for a moment and try to answer this. Scalar, we know, is the quantity which has got magnitude. Okay, vector is the quantity which has got a magnitude and a direction. Okay, and what is this? Is stress a scalar or vector? Well, the answer is, it is neither a scalar nor a vector, but it is a more general quantity called tensor. A tensor, for the time being, you understand, stress is a quantity which has got two directions and one magnitude. This is something new. Yes, we will see later in the next module. We will go in detail and understand what is the meaning of this tensor also. Okay. So now we will discuss the types of stresses. So we have discussed stress as intensity of internal resistance, or it's a force per unit area, that is force divided by the area. Now there are only two types of stresses available in mechanics of material. Everything else is sub classification of this. Okay, it's something like only there are two types of people, that is a male and female. Every other classification just arbitrary. Similarly, in case of mechanics of material, only we will study two types of stress, that is normal stress and shear stress. That's all. So here I have shown a body subjected to normal stress, that is in the left. See, we will show the normal stress. Okay, this is your normal stress and this is your shear stress. The first difference between a normal stress and shear stress is, I would like to call what is known as standing force here. This is standing force, this is sleeping force. The force that you are applying, if it is perpendicular to the cross section area, if this is area and if the force is perpendicular, then the resulting stress, the resulting intensity of force, that is force per unit area, is known as normal stress. That is, if the forces are perpendicular to the cross section area that you are considering, then it is a normal stress. If the forces are parallel to the area, they are sleeping like this, okay, then you call it as shear stress. Okay, so the first difference is, the forces are standing forces, here sleeping forces, that is forces here are normal, that is perpendicular to the surface area. Here they are parallel to the surface area. Therefore, the definition of normal stress is, if the forces are perpendicular to the area, then the stress is called normal stress. If the forces are parallel to the area, then the stress is called shear stress. The formula more or less remains same. Only thing is we change notation. This sigma is used for normal stress. That is sigma is equal to P by A. This is force per unit area. This force is the standing force. That is the force perpendicular to the area divided by the cross section area. Okay, here we use the symbol called tau. Tau for shear stress. Okay, this is shear. Okay, the formula is again P by A. Only thing is this P refers to the slipping forces, that is the forces which are in the plane of cross section area. The cross section area remains same. If you are studying one particular cross section area, the area of that will remain same whether you calculate shear stress or normal stress. Only thing is the force that you are considering must be perpendicular in case of normal stress. The force that you are considering must be parallel in case of shear stress. So, as you say, P is equal to sum of the forces perpendicular to area, and here P refers to sum of the forces parallel to the area. That's the only difference. Now, we have shown this in a diagram, the normal stress and shear stress. Now, this person is applying a force. So, this is your area. Okay. So, you can see this hatched colored area. So, this entire area is applying a force perpendicular to the area. So, the resulting stress is your normal stress. Whereas, an interesting thing you can see here. Here is touching the surface but is applying force like this in the plane of the cross section area. Then the resulting force divided by area will give you shear stress. Now, if this is P, okay, similarly this is P. Okay, the area remains same here. This is area, this is that area. So, if you want to find out normal stress, the sigma is equal to P by A as usual. Here shear stress tau is equal to again P by A. Only thing is the force applied by the hand on the surface is parallel to the surface. Whereas in this case, in the normal case, force applied by the hand on the surface is perpendicular. So, if the force is perpendicular, we call it as normal stress. If the force is parallel, we call it as shear stress. Okay. Okay, before we go further, we need to have some questions clarified, because especially the shear stress is often confusing to students. My own experience, I've seen normal stress is easily understood, but shear stress is not. Therefore, let's try to answer few questions and then try to get some more insight into the types of stresses. The first question is, what if the two rubbing surfaces are smooth? Remember, when you talk about shear stress, I'm talking about shear stress here. One surface has to rub or slide with respect to other surface, then only you can apply shear stress. There is a rubbing of two surfaces in case of shear stress. Now the question is, if the two rubbing surfaces are smooth. So if you see in the earlier example, the rubbing surfaces are the palm, the lower portion of the palm, and the upper portion of this area are the two rubbing surfaces. Okay. So in this case, when it's applying shear here, the lower portion of the palm and the top portion of this box are in contact. The two surfaces are rubbing each other. Therefore, there is shear existing here. Whereas in this case, if you talk about normal force, there is no rubbing. It is directly applying the force downwards. There is no rubbing action here. So, there is no rubbing action in normal stress. Whereas there is a rubbing action in case of shear stress. Now, the question is, what if the two rubbing surfaces are smooth? Can we apply shear stress or not? Is the question. Think for a while. Now the answer is, if the two parallel rubbing surfaces are smooth, you just can't apply shear forces. Keep this in mind. Because if the surfaces are smooth, one surface will simply slide over the other surface and will not be able to apply any shear forces. For any force to be applied, there should be a resistance. If the bottom portion is not resisting, the top surface will simply slide over. There is no question of force or there is no question of shear stress. This is to be understood very clearly. If the two rubbing surfaces are extremely smooth, there is no friction for the sliding, there will not be any shear stress, you will not be able to apply any shear stress. Imagine if you rub your hand on extremely smooth surface, you will not be able to apply any force, it simply slip and your hand will move forward. So that is the meaning of, if the two rubbing surfaces have to be rough or they should offer resistance, only then you can apply shear stress. The similar related question is, how can we apply shear forces? As I said already, there should be some friction between the surfaces, that is there should be local resistance to sliding, only then shear forces and hence shear stress can exist. So this is to be understood very clearly. For even if the surfaces are smooth, you can apply normal force, not an issue, but for applying shear stress or shear force, there should be a local resistance to the sliding. Now the question is, we have written same formula for both normal stress and shear stress, that is P by A. How is that? Can you use the same formula? Is it same? Okay. Yes, the formula for normal stress and shear stress is same. Only the meaning of force is different. Okay. In normal stress, the P refers to the sum of perpendicular forces. Okay. These are perpendicular forces. Whereas the P in shear stress is sum of horizontal forces or parallel forces or shear forces. So that's the only difference. If you are taking forces which are perpendicular surface and divide by the area, you will get normal stress. If you take the forces which are parallel to the surface and divide by the area, you will get shear stress. Now the question is, the force that you are applying is neither normal nor parallel to the surface, then how to calculate the shear stress or normal stress or what stress is acting? I don't know. So in this case, our concept that we have introduced in the beginning, that is a resolution of forces, is important. As you can see in this figure, there is a surface and a force of delta F is being applied. This delta F is neither parallel to the horizontal surface or this area of interest, it is not perpendicular to this. So what we have to do is, in such cases, we have to resolve this force into two components. One is, this is normal component, that is perpendicular area. Another one is shear component, this is parallel to the area. Of course, if you know the theta, that is angle between these two, you can easily find out. This is delta F, means this horizontal component will be delta F cos theta and the vertical component will be delta F sin theta. So to finding out normal stress is very simple. The sigma is equal to delta F, normal force means it is sin theta in this case. I'm sorry, this is so the normal force is given by delta F sin theta divided by delta A, and the shear stress is given by delta F cos theta by delta A. Because I have taken theta in this fashion, the horizontal component will be cos theta and vertical component is sin theta. If I had taken theta like this, then the vertical here, if I had taken theta, then vertical component would have been cos theta and horizontal would have been sin theta. So cos theta is that component at which theta is attached, okay, that you should remember. So as I already answered, the force must be resolved or split into two components, one parallel to the surface and another perpendicular to the surface. In this case, both normal force and shear forces are acting, and you will have to both normal and shear stress acting on the same surfaces. No. So here you can't say only normal force is acting or shear force is acting. Both the normal stress as well as shear stress are acting in this case. So how to calculate the normal stress and shear stress? This is very simple. Okay, you just count or sum all the perpendicular forces that are acting on the surface divided by the area to get the normal surface. Similarly, if you sum up all the parallel forces and divide by the area, you will get shear stresses. Is there any further classification of normal stress and shear stress? Yes, normal stress can be further, normal stress, you know, it is force perpendicular to it. So this normal stress can be of two type. One is positive stress, another one is negative stress. So what do you mean by positive stress? Positive stress is also called tensile stress. If the force acting on the surface is away from the area, which is trying to pull the area away, then this is your normal tensile stress or positive stress. Instead, if the force is acting inside the area, towards the area, and trying to compress the surface, then it is compressive stress. So normal stress is again it is perpendicular only. Only thing is if it is moving away from the area, the resulting stress is normal tensile stress. If it is moving towards the inside the area, then it is normal compressive stress. Let us take a simple problem to understand more about the shear stresses. So here we have given a prismatic bar with a rectangular cross section. Okay, so that means this there are two bodies here. One is the lower portion. Okay, this is your elastic body which is flexible enough, and that on the top of that you have placed a rigid body. Okay, and you can see the interface here. Okay, when somebody tries to apply a force V on this top surface, so because this is rigid body, will try to move. And at this intersection where the top portion, that is the bottom portion of the top body and the top portion of the bottom body are interacting here, there is a connection between this. Okay, two surfaces are attached here along this point. Okay, now if the given force is 70 kilonewton, okay, you are applying a force that is parallel force of 70 kilonewton, and let us take A as, let us say this B is given as 20 mm. This is 20 and this is 40. How to find out the shear stress? Okay, if you observe carefully, I have just removed the top rigid body and I am only showing the bottom portion here, the elastic body. All along this, because wherever there is a contact, you will find there will be shear stresses. Okay, there will be rubbing action by the top body on its lower portion. Okay. So these small forces will add up and will be equal to 70 kilonewton. So what is the area on which these forces are acting? So this is 20, sorry, this is 40. Okay, so the shear stress formula we know, it is tau is equal to P by A. So what is P? P tau is equal to P by A. Only thing is the P should be horizontal, or that is parallel force. Okay, this is given problem, it is parallel force only. We are applying 70 kilonewton, that is 70 into 10 power 3 newton. Divided by the area. Area is what? We have 20 cross 40. That is 20 okay, so we can substitute 70 into 10 power 3 newton for force, and area is 20 cross 40, that is 20 into 10 power minus 3 meter, and 40 into 10 power minus 3 meter. Please remember, always while doing problems, convert all the units into SI system and solve. That will be more easier, otherwise it can create so many problems in the later stages. So when you divide, you will get 87.5 into 10 power 6, which turns out to be 87.5 megapascal. So given one more problem, that's a conceptive problem. Only difference is we have got a 6.4 kilonewton force being applied, and again top surface is 40 mm, and this cross 40 mm, height is 40 mm. This height is not important here because the forces are being applied only on the top surface. Okay, so that will be the shear stress in this case will be 6.4 divided by 40 into 40. Just try to get the answer for that.